Hi, and welcome to the SEO podcast, Unknown Secrets of Internet Marketing. My name is Chris Burris, owner of eWebStyle.
I am Charles Lewis, with Internet Marketing Specialist.
Welcome to the most popular internet marketing podcast on iTunes. Remember, that is only because of you.
You listening, if you can't see us pointing, you should watch it.
Yeah, come watch the podcast. We broadcast live on Fridays.
Yeah, sometime before 12.
At some time. Make sure you're following us on Twitter, twitter.com/eWebStyle. Because right before we go on air, we actually post a tweet or tweet. that is live on the air, so you can hear, watch a little bit of background stuff as we're getting prepped for the podcast, and then boom, you're already there watching the podcast.
Ready to go.
And just so you know, the place that you could watch the podcast is e-webstyle.com/SEO podcast. Boom, good. You're on top of it. remember, we are your friendly local neighborhood top position snatchers, yes. Where our mantra is,
don't be a deuce.
It's not a good look. We need like a douche mascot and then like a cool mascot.
And so the douche mascot would just get beat up all the time.
By the cool mascot and random people walking by. I don't know if we could hire anyone to be the douche mascot. You'd just be getting kicked in the shins the whole time.
All day.
If you can, we've already mentioned Twitter. If you can, go ahead and tweet now. And what should they tweet?
Hashtag SEO podcast. This is number 183, so make sure you tag us in it at eWebStyle when you do that.
As always, we have a tip from a previous podcast. This is podcast number 183. Our tip from podcast number 182 is, when doing SEO for mobile, remember to make the navigation easy for touchscreens.
Yeah, definitely. We were talking about, you know, some of the differences between maybe doing a mobile site or having a mobile app. But the gist of it all is, make sure you take into consideration the device people are using. If it's a touch screen, then your navigation should be easy, so people won't fat finger it or get lost trying to do certain things on your site. So take into consideration the mobile device you're optimizing for, and make sure that your page is compatible.
Well, here's a good one, and we had this recently on the website with the navigation. You click hover over the navigation, and the navigation opens, and then you could select one of the options in that open window. On a touchscreen device, there is no hover. Mm-hmm. and that the actual main link. So let's say it was services, and then under it was we'll say plumbing and heater installation or whatever. Services was actually a link. So on a touchscreen device, you could never get to the heater or whatever. You click it and it automatically took you to services. So do some testing with mobile devices.
I forgot which site that was. Well, we ended up making it so you could, if you held your finger on the actual nav item, then the drop down menu would appear without clicking.
Well, we actually, at the exact time we were experiencing that problem, we had another site that had been done with different technology. One was Drupal, one was WordPress. Mm-hmm. The one in WordPress worked fine, the one in Drupal didn't. That's not a WordPress Drupal issue, that's just how the templates were made issue, I think. I don't necessarily want to point the fingers at Drupal. You know what? We'll blame it on Drupal. Let's just do that. Remember, there's lots of ways you can follow us, stalk us, haunt us, harass us, and communicate with us. Some of those are facebook.com/eWebStyle, twitter.com/eWebStyle, youtube.com/eWebStyle. Hey, Alex, how's it going? Don't try and sneak by there. He's all tiptoe. I don't want to make any noise.
Yeah, he's like the biggest guy in the office. Like, we all see you.
Yeah.
You're not invisible.
We actually got rid of our ladders in our office. Hey, Alex, can you help me? I can't reach that. And he was trying to sneak by. It was a nice attempt.
Funny, yeah.
So remember, there are other ways that you can harass us and follow us. We like it when you write reviews. And there's two places that we're really focusing reviews on. So if you get any value out of this podcast, and we hope you do, or any entertainment value, we'll go with both of those.
Yeah.
There's something that you can do on iTunes. It's just three steps. Go to iTunes, create an account, write a review. If you choose to, send us an email, podcast@t-wolfstar.com, and let us know, and we'll give you a punch in the face. The other place we like a review is e-webstyle.com/g
plus.
And
I forgot the other one. I was so focused on that one.
Yeah, plus.
G plus.
Yeah. And
G plus.
Mm-hmm. And
G
plus.
Yeah.
Google.
Google. Oh man, see, trying to do something new. Yeah. G plus and G plus and Google plus and yeah.
Google plus. Google write plus. It out or use the symbol.
Yeah.
It's a shame when your creativity gets in the way of your functionality and productivity.
Basically, go there, man. Leave us a review. That'll take you straight to our places page. And just hit us up. Let us know which number you listen to, what you got out of it. And we appreciate it.
Excellent. And one last little order of business. Remember, we do have a referral program. That's where you can engage us, either white label or otherwise, and get compensated for having sent us some business. So it's a great way if you're having some SEO clients that you're not able to handle. Or you do web design and don't really want to get into SEO. We mm-hmm. certainly can appreciate that. There were years that we just did web design and didn't do SEO. Send that our direction and you can continue to get compensated.
You can get paid.
All right. So there were, so I was at the tattoo parlor last night. I was like, do I put on a tattoo? Do I not put on a tattoo? Because we got some love on Facebook. We appreciate that. We didn't have any reviews on iTunes or on G+.
It's kind of like a hollow tat, maybe.
Yeah.
Okay.
So I just had him punch me in the face. The love we did get on Facebook is great. This one is from Nathan. Because you know on the radio they never mention last names because I think the legal reason is they don't know for sure if it's that person. Mm-hmm. I guess we probably could because Facebook's pretty strict about it, but I think we probably should just shift to Nathan, and if you want to find the last name, go onto our Facebook page.
There you go.
What we got from, it's a picture of
because Facebook is public, right?
Yeah.
So he like posted that on our wall.
So we'll go Nathan Stewart says, love your podcast. I listen to them while I work my night job cleaning. Definitely helps pass the time. Thank you for all the effort that goes into it. Keep up the good work. That's from Sarasota, Florida.
Punch in the face to you, Nathan.
Punch in the working late face right there. Next, we got Pamela Herman. Found your podcast on iTunes. Glad to find you.
Glad you found
me. Exactly. And this is one, it was a question, and we answered it actually on Facebook. I don't think we answered this on air. It says, question for us. This is from Deborah Richmond. I changed my page title description, and suddenly my website disappeared from page one of Google searches. Is that common?
I changed my page title description. So, did you change title and description, or are you just talking about the page title, which I think that's what you're referring to? And if indeed you just changed your title, then yeah, you very well could have dropped. The title is one of the key elements to on-page SEO. And if indeed your title, if you ranked for a certain phrase that maybe was in your title and you removed that phrase, then you probably won't rank for that phrase anymore. Fix that.
I responded and just said basically lots of factors. We're not really sure. Send us your site and we'll give you an analysis on that. All right, into a little bit of news. Google is sued in the European Union. Now, this is something really interesting. You know, we grow up here. We're kind of in this American cocoon. I know the rest of the world recognizes it, doesn't necessarily understand it. Mm-hmm. And we have our concept of free speech. Mm-hmm. And the kind of
say what I want to say.
Exactly. Mm-hmm. And apparently the concept of free speech is slightly different
everywhere else.
And I always kind of assumed it was the same in the European Union, and apparently it's different. Google's getting sued, and basically some guy went and typed his name, and an article that is in an existing newspaper website came up on Google. That's what Google does.
Yeah.
And he decided to sue them. Because he apparently, according to European Union's concepts, has the right for that not to show up. Now, what I don't understand is why isn't he suing the newspaper?
Yeah, because Google did nothing but pull some content that they already published.
Yeah, I mean, it's public information Google pulled. It's just interesting that they actually mentioned something that which
he should
is...
should be thanking Google, because now he knows that that content's there.
Go after the newspaper. Yeah. Now, what is the newspaper going to do? We wrote it. What's really interesting is the court is putting Google in this weird position where they're not actually a publisher, but they're responsible for
sharing the content.
Well, for pulling down content. Well, like, so the actual publisher of the information has the right to leave it up there, apparently, but Google doesn't, ostensibly in this case, doesn't have the right to display that that information is there, which is... The
weird.
Whole thing is bizarre to me, if you ask me. So anybody over in the European Union, you know, Darren Bowie, hit us up. Give us your opinion on this.
On how that should go. What should happen is the news company should go and pull down that content and then, you know, then even block it from their robots file if it shouldn't be displayed at all.
Yeah.
And then once Google indexes the site, then that content won't be available.
It won't, yeah, it'll disappear. There was a concept they mentioned, which I've never really heard of, which is the right to be forgotten.
Yeah, that's, well, I almost said something. Okay.
Yeah, that doesn't really work for our sensibility, right? The way we grow up. Now, in court, I know you have the ability to expunge a case, which really makes it totally disappear. In terms of publication and free speech, you don't have that right.
It's like, out there.
And frankly, my perspective is, I think that's a good thing. If you did something wrong long ago, you know, people have the right to know that you did wrong long ago. If you're in a hiring situation, if you're in a situation where you're going to engage somebody in services, you know, whatever. If my mortgage broker went to jail, you know, 10 years ago, I may want to know about it. I may want to bring it up. I think conceptually we believe that you have the right to move on.
Mm-hmm. And you do.
And you do. And so I can ask you about that. But for me, like, I don't know. If you did something a long time ago, I want to know. Anyway, let's move on to anybody in the European Union or any other place who has opinions about this. Hit us up on Facebook, facebook.com/ewebstar. And that'd be, I think, just a very, very interesting discussion. You kind of grow up assuming everyone has kind of similar understandings of fundamental concepts like free speech, and it's actually not true. Google has a ZOP file, and I know I mentioned something recently, either last podcast or podcast before, where Google was able to actually reduce the server load because their image compression technology was better. This isn't specifically image compression. It's just something to make the internet faster. And I just wanted to give a punch in the face to Google, because anything you're doing to make the internet faster, I love it. There was a little article on syncing photos. It was talking about using Dropbox and SugarSync. And one of the best ones that I use, I just wanted to throw this out there, is G+. You have that feature turned on now?
No, I have not turned it on. Because I'm just leery about every picture I take getting posted.
Well, so remember, it's private. You have to go back out there and share it.
Okay. So right? It just uploads it.
It just uploads it, and it's only visible to you.
Okay.
So yeah, I know you're concerned. Yeah.
Man, I just, you know, sorry, wifey.
Yeah, I didn't know that you were going to be on the internet. I didn't even intend to take a photo those 13 times. And I thought this was interesting. The Groupon CEO, if you read the memo, the Groupon CEO, he sent out a memo. He said, okay, Groupon, I've decided to spend more time with my family and children. Also part of his family. Just kidding, I got fired. And then he goes on to say, if you don't know why I got fired, you haven't been paying attention.
Yeah.
I thought it was brilliant. I thought it was really good. And you know what his compensation is? Compensation is going to be, he's going to get like 3 months of salary. It's like $350 or something, because he was getting some really low amount. Of course, he's walking away from the whole experience with $200 million, and there was a discussion in the comments section.
Yeah.
I don't even get, like, who can hate on a dude? He founded the company. He's walking away with $200 million because he founded the company.
And now, what they should do, you know, I hope they are in the process of changing their model, because the model made him a lot of money. And frankly, it probably worked for tons of new businesses who could afford to take that hit or that loss to start. But for most small businesses who would like to take advantage of that sort of program, is not financially feasible. And so, yeah, I think the model should change some.
Or I think it's okay as long as the people getting into it know
that you're going to...
We were visiting a client the other day who got on there, sold like 10,000 whatever facials or something,
mm-hmm.
and they were just not prepared to handle 10,000 mm-hmm. facials
at
their salon.
At the same time, you know, doing a lot of work, incurring a lot of cost, using a lot of resources, and these people are only paying 25% of what it normally would have costed.
And what they got in return? Bad reviews. Yeah, that kind of sucks. All right, that is the potatoes. Time to get into the meat or some tweets.
Got some shout-outs. Punches in the face.
Time to get to some tweets and then the meat.
So these punches face goes to We Save Bees. This is on Twitter, at We Save Bees OC. They tweeted, I started at 1. I'm almost up to date. I usually get 5 or 6 per day while saving bees.
Wow, that's cool.
Yeah.
We're like the bee saving podcast.
Then we got Dan Frigo. He's at Frigo Dan. He says, SEO Podcast 179 on his lunch break. A punch in the face to Eddie Webstyle. Patis to you
back
too,
to you,
Dan.
Yeah.
Last one, James Anderson. He's at James WD Anderson. SEO Podcast, hashtag, he did that. Thanks for following instructions. Thanks for the great work, guys. Patif for your tips. I'm able to help my clients more than ever. James, that's what's up. I'm glad it's working for you.
To you.
You know, let me know what you did. What tip did we give that you actually implemented that worked? I'll be curious to hear about that and see if we had some of those same results.
Absolutely.
So that was the tweets, not to the meat. So I want to talk about, pulled a good article here from Search Engine Journal. I want to talk about 8 strategies to get multiple first page rankings on Google. And so when I saw the title, I began to think about, okay, search results pages. It's always, we talk about a lot, you know, people doing paid, right? And
right.
doing, or natural listings, they're ranking
well.
So you have at least 2. And maybe if you get a local listing, then you have 3, right? And so which is always good. And so I was interested in seeing what other sorts of
ideas,
SERP rankings could you get. And so before I even get into the article, I began to think about, which I want to share with you guys, the type of listings there are.
Yeah.
So there is a paid, right? Then there's your local, then
right.
there's your natural. But when you look at those natural listings, you get kind of a subset of listings. Some may be video.
Yep.
Some may be images.
Yeah.
If it's a product, you may see a shopping section
right.
with products,
and that shopping section could also be upper right.
Mm-hmm. You may have site links, and so there's different all kinds of ways to really get on the first page of Google, not just a kind of standard natural listing. And so it was my assumption that his article would kind of dive into most of those, and that is exactly what he did. So number one is the image, and I this is key. You know, optimizing your images has always been kind of a default SEO thing. Alt tags, make sure they're titled right, make sure the file size isn't extremely big, and make sure it loads fast and it's kind of clear and things like that. But this is even more important now because the number of people who do image searches continues to rise. Google, Chris was just giving news about Google doing stuff to help the image search. Google just released a way to now you can drag and drop.
Ooh, drop. I like that. Well, why use 2 words? You can drop.
Yeah.
Which means drag. Oh, I like that.
You can, I guess that would, well, drop. I don't know where I got
that. I like it. Drop. It's going to go in our glossary.
So, yeah, you can drop images right into the Google search, and it'll pull images that look similar to that one. And so the point of the matter is people are using image search. And so you must optimize your images. Because
yeah.
when you do an image search on Google and that image shows and you click it and you like it, it takes you to that page, which is essentially on your website.
Yeah.
So take advantage of image search. That's another way to get a listing on the first page. Number 2 on here is local. And so we were just talking local earlier today. Make sure you're taking advantage of your local plus page. Make sure you have that set up and it's configured correctly with all your information, because if it's a local search, then you definitely want to be there. Local searches get clicked most. They listed higher than the typical organic listings. And so that's another way to be on the search engine results page.
And it just stands out.
And it stands out, exactly. Number three is video, right? So if you have a video, optimize that video. Make sure you've tagged it right. Make sure the title is keyword rich. Make sure you have enough supporting content in the description. Speak clear on the video because Google's transcribing it. And so all these sorts of things help that video to get placed on that first page of the search results pretty quickly if the video is relevant to the search query. So make sure you have a decent video. I will sprinkle this in when doing video. People have short attention spans. And so and it's kind of a double-edged sword, right? Because at the end of the day, some people will watch a 5 or 10 minute video before they read 3 paragraphs.
Yeah.
Even though the 3 paragraphs can be read in, 30, 40 seconds.
Right.
But at the same time, most people will only watch a video up to 2 minutes before they kind of transition out and either watch something different or change it or lose interest. So if you're going to do video, make sure it's optimized well and keep it short. Keep it right to the point, unless it's a TV show or whatever it is that needs to be that long. Number four, news. So news is really good, especially with Google spending a lot of investment in news and making sure people can have the right feeds, and so the latest news and the best news can come up pretty effectively and quickly. Make sure having news on your site is a great way to get to the first page of the SERPs, especially if you're reporting on, let's say, current events or things that happen to change frequently. Then as long as you have the most updated news, then you're likely to get that ranking faster. And so take advantage of having news, take advantage of having current news, if that's your thing. One of the problems I had a separate blog site I run. I just don't have time to update it.
Right.
And so when I do update it, it's usually the whole month's worth of news.
Right.
You know what I'm saying? Here you go, bam, 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 bam. I'm going to have to just assign that to somebody because we need to have
news.
Well,
there's probably a scheduler that you could use.
But I still need to write the content.
So you end up writing all the content, and you need to get that content up because the time frame. Yeah.
This news, yeah. Yep. So, yeah.
Delegate.
Exactly. Next one, site links. Take advantage of site links. And the easiest way to really get site links is to properly title your pages. If you title your pages right and you follow up with the right permalinks or URL structure or friendly URLs or pretty URLs, whatever your CMS calls them, then you'll likely get better site links. Make sure that those site links are in your main nav. What I'm noticing is that you don't really see too much sub-nav in site links. It's usually top nav.
Right.
Go figure. So have your important pages part of your top nav and with the correct page titles, and then you will likely rank higher for a site link. Now, I will say that site links usually only show when it's a search that is really brand focused, or like maybe they mention your domain name in that search.
In the search, yeah.
Then you'll have a higher likelihood of getting the site links to show. The next one is shopping. So if you're selling products, this is kind of similar to the site links. Make sure that product page is optimized well. You have a description. Your product name should be the page title, frankly. Make sure you have everything synced up with your Google base and merchant. And so that way your product is listed in their database because they will show shopping results. And if your product is there and is well optimized, then you have a higher likelihood of that product being shown on the first page of Google. So take advantage of the shopping section if you're having an e-commerce site. I will say OpenCart does a great job of automatically syncing that feed with your Google account. So you can, every time you add products, it'll automatically push those into the Google base. Take advantage of that. Let me sprinkle this in just from a reporting perspective. If you're using analytics and you're using OpenCart, get the plugin. It's called e-commerce analytics.
That sounds about right.
Yeah, e-commerce analytics is a plug. Man, it's awesome. It'll go into analytics and show you not only which keyword led to a transaction, but how much that transaction was, down to if you're doing paid PPC with it, how much did you spend based on it. It's pretty cool.
Yep.
Anyway, check that out. It's really effective if you're tracking you know, paid budgets versus how much product is selling. It's just a great tool to have. So yeah, e-commerce for analytics, that's what OpenCart. Site link shopping, third-party sites. And so this one's a good one. SEO Moz does a good example of this. And this is something maybe we should probably try.
Right.
So third-party sites, right? So let's say you have a product, but you put it on a separate domain name. So you look up anything SEO, SEO Moz will likely get the several results on the first page. But one of those results may also be for Open Site Explorer,
right?
Which is an SEO Moz product. But it's so big of a product that it's on its own domain name. It has its own features, its own page structure, and everything else. But at the end of the day, it's still an SEO Moz product. And so that's a third-party site.
Right.
Maybe we'll do a, you know, internetmarketingpodcast.com or something like that.
Right.
And it'll strictly feature this podcast. And if you search for it, it'll probably outrank, you know, ewebstyle.com/SEO podcast. But it's still us. It's still our company, our branding, and everything else. So third-party sites work well. Lastly, he put additional domain names. And this kind of goes back to, you know, something Google does real well. You know, if we're in the States, it's .com. If you're, across the pond, then it's .co.uk, right? And so take advantage of different domain names when possible. Because depending on the search query, there may be a need to show both.
Right.
And now you have, you know, different results on the same search engine result page. And so if you do all of these right, you likely won't get, you know, a video, your product, and some site links on the homepage. But if you can get, you know, one or two extra listings, or maybe one of them bumps your other listing higher because now it's taking up more real estate at the bottom of the first page. Then at the end of the day, it's more traffic and more revenue. So
absolutely, more
multiple listings on the homepage. I will go post that on Facebook, and I encourage you guys to comment and tell me what you think about it.
All right, excellent. That it? We got some blank stare.
Got a little blank stare. Right. A little blank stare. Yeah, that was the arm folded, kind of frustrated blank stare. This one goes to all of our left wing and right wing people up in D.C. Like, come on, man, this is a Quifta deal. We don't get too much into politics here, but work it out, dog. Work it out.
Make it happen.
At the end of the day, you know what I'm saying? We all gonna either benefit or suffer from it, and there's no need for that. So
you're working for us. Do something.
Exactly.
Do some work.
Work it out, man. Come on.
All right. This has been podcast number 183. You have been listening to the most popular SEO podcast and the most popular internet marketing podcast on iTunes. That is because of all of y'all. Thank you very much. Again, send us an email, podcast@e-webstyle.com, and we'll give you a punch in the face.
Yep.
Until the next podcast, my name is Chris Burris.
Charles Lewis.
Bye-bye for now.